It is undeniable that both carbon dioxide levels and global temperatures are rising. However, while global temperatures have not yet reached their record highest, carbon dioxide levels have nearly doubled from past records, reaching concentrations of almost 420 parts per million. Alone, the temperature rise might not be alarming, as it has cycled about every 100,000 years between lower and higher temperatures, but the high carbon dioxide levels make the rise worrying. Looking at ice cores and other methods of historical atmosphere data collection, scientists have created graphs which show that carbon dioxide and temperature tend to rise together. If carbon dioxide is rising this much, what does that say about our current temperature increase? Naturally, carbon dioxide cycles through our atmosphere during photosynthesis and cellular respiration, as well as through decomposition. Unfortunately, our use of fossil fuels as well as deforestation is disrupting the cycle. With the combustion of fossil fuels, such as in plastic production or driving gas-powered vehicles and airplanes, we release long-buried stores of carbon, which have been out of commission, in a sense, and end up raising carbon dioxide levels. While deforestation adds to carbon dioxide levels, this is less of the problem. This carbon dioxide was recently taken out of the atmosphere during photosynthesis, so its return does less to imbalance the total carbon dioxide levels. What's more of a problem is the loss of carbon sequestration. Through the process of photosynthesis, trees take in carbon dioxide, in addition to sunlight and water, to transform it into glucose, a sugar, which it uses for energy and stores in itself in the process. Deforestation removes this vital ecosystem service. Thus, we have created an increase in carbon dioxide, which is a greenhouse gas. While greenhouse gases, including carbon dioxide, as well as methane and nitrous oxide, are important for life on Earth because they allow for heat from the sun to be trapped in our atmosphere to make it warm enough for life, such an unprecedented increase is less than ideal. Among other related problems, global warming allows for ecological zones to spread. This means that as higher latitudes warm, they become available living spaces for species which like warmer environments, namely disease vectors and invasives. These organisms tend to be generalist and are selected species. They are highly adaptable because they can survive on a wide variety of food and habitat resources, and they have high biotic potential, or they reproduce with strategies geared towards quantity over quality. What does the spread of vectors mean? The impact of their spread can and will be seen in the spread of vector-borne diseases like malaria, Zika, or dengue fever. As the habitats of mosquito vectors grow, the disease can spread to more parts of the world. While the primary cause of invasive species is actually human activity transporting species intentionally, such as with kudzu for erosion, or unintentionally, such as with zebra mussels in ship ballast water, the problems connected to their spread tie into global warming. Species which couldn't survive in cooler weather are able to thrive in a wider range of habitat. This is a threat to specialist species who require specific food and habitat resources, and case-selected species who breed with quality rather than quantity strategies. Perhaps at first the threat of invasives doesn't seem worrying, but biodiversity is threatened when invasives outcompete natives, decreasing species richness or the number of different species and their species evenness, making the ecosystem more susceptible to damages. With its slew of issues from rising sea levels and coral bleaching to the spread of disease vectors and invasives, global warming is quite obviously a threat to global biodiversity, not to mention its effects on human health and safety. As the famous Dr. Seuss wrote in his children's book, The Lorax, "Unless someone like you cares a whole awful lot, nothing is going to get better." So what can you do? Simple actions like reducing your plastic use, riding a bike or walking instead of driving, and installing Energy Star approved appliances are great day-to-day suggestions. Writing to your local congressperson or government to petition for stricter emission regulations or funding for cleaner, greener energy sources, or finding an environmentally conscious organization to invest in or donate to, is a way you can take part in making an impact on a larger scale. Every small step counts, but doing nothing is simply letting the issue linger and grow. Do your part to save our home.